Tonight on Greenwatch, President Bush, in his new energy policy, pushes nuclear power. For many, it's a reminder of the disaster at Chernobyl. For others, the new technology of safer plants makes nuclear power an attractive alternative to fossil fuels. What's the answer? Watch one man's attempt to find out next. Good evening, I'm Ann McGrath, and welcome back to Greenwatch, New England's program on the environment. Nuclear power. In the 50s, it looked like the answer to all our energy needs. In the 70s, it looked like one of the biggest environmental threats. Now, with global warming, smog, and other strikes against fossil fuels, many of us are wondering if nuclear power demands a second look. Tonight, filmmaker Ron Blau presents a documentary report which takes that second look in the kind of personal way that any of us would. And Ron, could you tell us how you approach this complex issue?
Well, Anne, I wanted to approach this not as a journalist with all the distance that implies, but as what we all are, a citizen, a member of a democracy, a parent, and of course we're all consumers of energy. I suppose I'm like a lot of people these days. Every time I switch on a light or fire up an appliance, I feel guilty as hell. Don't you? You know what I mean? More and more people crowding the planet, using more and more resources, which makes me and you part of the problem, just by being alive and being consumers. So what do? Life is electric. We live by the stuff.
For a long time, I've been trying to say that nuclear power is not only an acceptable way to make electricity, that's what it's all about, making electricity. It's more than acceptable, it's preferable.
Trouble is, for every opinion, there's an opposite opinion that sounds just as convincing.
Despite 40 years of promises, $200 billion worth of federal taxpayer subsidies, the nuclear industry still has not come up with a competitive product.
Before we get too deeply into the pros and cons of nuclear power, I should say that I've been scratching out a living working on films and TV programs since John F. Kennedy was president. In all that time, naturally, some of the stories touched on nuclear issues.
I'm sure you and I wouldn't want to be here, wouldn't be here, if there was any question in our minds about the safety of the planet.
Well, just about exactly 20 years ago, a bunch of us made this film for the electric companies of New England. We had some doubts about doing it, but my boss Dave was very, very smart, and he read all about nuclear power and convinced me that it was a good thing and safe.
We have a little control here, move it one way. It's like stepping on the gas pedal of a car. Pulls the control rods up.
Of course, that was years before Three Mile Island. By 1979, what with Three Mile Island and a growing fear of nuclear war, I'd come to believe a lot of what activist Dr. Helen Caldicott stood for.
2, 4, 6, 8, we don't want to radiate!
Nuclear power, along with nuclear weapons, ought to be banished. I even worked a bit on this film, which was called 8 Minutes to Midnight.
What happened in Harrisburg? What would have happened if that had have melted down, and by the grace of God, it did not melt?
My ex-wife, who produced this film, got nominated for an Academy Award. That rankled a bit, but you get over these things. Well, times change, and we change with them. Another decade, another marriage, and now I have my daughter's future to think about. Should her world be nuclear? On the one hand, it's hard to forget Chernobyl. On the other hand, today we believe that fossil fuels, like the oil and gas and coal used in cars and power plants, are contributing to the greenhouse effect, which might end up a lot worse than Chernobyl. And now, as if things weren't complicated enough, Saddam Hussein not only grabs Kuwait and all its oil wells, he allegedly dumps disastrous amounts of crude into the Persian Gulf.
The slick, according to the Americans, was 8 to 10 miles long.
It's enough to make you want to give up fossil fuels forever. All of which means it's time to take a fresh look at nuclear power. Maybe the balance has tipped again. Maybe nuclear power should be the energy of choice for the 1990s. I'm not an expert. I'm not a scientist, but I am a citizen of this democracy. And I wanted to visit a nuclear power plant to get a feel for the subject. But the powers that be wouldn't let a crew from Greenwatch into Pilgrim or Seabrook. They said that, you guessed it, Saddam Hussein had made them extra cautious about security. Yankee Row in the Berkshires was more relaxed. They wouldn't exactly let us inside, but they would let us tape on their property and talk to some of their people. So Bones Fisher, who shot and edited this story, drove out with me to Western Massachusetts. We stopped along the way to grab some coffee and think up some questions. The Riverside restaurant and bakery was empty, except for the two owners. I decided to do an informal survey, which revealed that 100% of the people here were against nuclear power.
We don't really know how to dispose of the wastes. Well, there's absolutely no solutions that are viable.
We have all that money we could be pouring into alternative energy, and I don't know why we never did it.
I thought I should talk to the people at Yankee Row about safety issues and what to do with nuclear wastes. Also, is nuclear maybe a viable choice for environmental reasons? We'll see.
All my neighbors know that I work here, and I've told them, I said, I like my pink body just as much as you like yours, and I sure, if there's any danger in there, I sure wouldn't be here. I'd be working in some other industry.
Carl Jurentkov was a very likable and reassuring guy. He didn't seem at all defensive. Hearing him talk, I felt easier about being a few feet away from that throbbing radioactive core. In the Deerfield River Valley, dominated by the white sphere of the Yankee Row reactor, I felt strangely peaceful, in touch with nature. I could almost sense the wildlife all around us.
Well, 4 years ago, we had an eagle that was discovered living in these trees along here.
Speaking of wildlife, Bill McGee, who's the public affairs director, took Bones and me to see the eagles that live by the power plant.
But they're usually right in that dead tree over there, and they must be off having lunch about now because they do swoop up and down the valley here.
I thought of making some wise guy remark like the eagles must be visiting their oncologist because of the radioactivity, but I'm sure very little radiation is released here. And I began worrying about getting off the track. I was here to ask some tough questions on topics like radiation leaks from nuclear plants, managing nuclear wastes, and of course, reactor safety.
Right in the middle here, in the red, is the reactor vessel itself. Now, inside the reactor vessel, of course, is the nuclear fuel.
This is a model of the Yankee Row reactor, the heart of the power plant where the uranium fuel gives off the heat that ends up generating electricity. Bill explained how fuel rods are protected by 6 inches of stainless steel, then thick concrete walls.
And then you've got the 1-inch stainless steel containment vessel itself around this thing, leading up to this idea of safety in depth that is engineered and designed into all the nuclear plants.
Remember Chernobyl in the USSR? The worst accident in the history of nuclear power. The accident was so bad because the reactor didn't have a sturdy containment structure around it. Just about every American nuclear plant has one. So even anti-nuclear experts don't worry about another Chernobyl happening here, but they have other concerns.
And no, the exact sequence of events that occurred at Chernobyl will not happen at a U.S. reactor, but a different sequence of events leading to an equally disastrous result could happen in the United States.
Joe Kreisberg worries that there could still be a meltdown severe enough to cause a containment vessel to fail and release a massive amount of radiation to the environment. Uh-oh. Here's a problem, conflicting experts. I had believed Bill McGee's reassurances, and I believed Carl Jurentkov even more, especially when he talked about not wanting to risk his own pink body. Now, Joe Kreisberg was saying they were wrong, and I believed him. This problem of dueling experts only got worse. There's an ongoing debate over the danger of low-level radiation. For example, at the Pilgrim Nuclear Power Station in Plymouth, the original fuel rods were defective. This problem was corrected, but it caused some radiation leakage in 1974 and 1975. critics claim people living downwind from the power plant were showered with enough radiation to cause several cases of leukemia.
We've seen here in Massachusetts with the Pilgrim reactor on the South Shore that the leukemia rate for people living within 10 miles of the plant is four times that of the people living outside the 10-mile radius.
That sounded awfully convincing until we talked to the head of radiological sciences at Mass General.
The recent study by the National Cancer Institute did not show that. They showed that the leukemia level around Pilgrim was about the same as it is anywhere else in the United States. It was not in excess.
So, do you believe the testimony of a PhD at a prestigious institution, or do you believe the head of an established grassroots organization? There's no way to know without doing a lot of research, which most of us ordinary citizens don't have time for or wouldn't know how to do. So we're put in the awkward position of having to rely on experts who disagree with each other.
Looks like a reactor scram. Derek, Lenny, perform your immediate actions of E0.
Meanwhile, back in western Massachusetts, Yankee Row led us into their $8 million mock-up of the control room. Here, reactor operators perfect their craft, including practicing for every conceivable emergency.
Check if SI's actuated.
SI's not actuated,
it's not required. Okay, Lenny, Derek, we're going to transition to ES0.1, reactor scram response.
Especially since the near meltdown of Three Mile Island, the nuclear industry has been working hard to perfect their equipment and procedures. But even if reactors operate flawlessly, what happens to the used-up uranium fuel? When it's no longer good for generating electricity, the fuel has to be removed and stored. How and where to store these highly radioactive wastes is a fiercely debated issue.
Nobody's developed the technology yet and tested the technology for long-term storage. Of course, it's difficult to test something that has to remain effective for anywhere between 5,000 and 240,000 years.
You think that waste ultimately can be managed, I mean, that it's not a technological
thing. Surprisingly, one environmentalist I talked to thought the problem of nuclear waste could be managed. Jim McKenzie of the World Resources Institute.
Look, we have to do a lot of things forever. To grow food. I mean, you think about it. I mean, you got to grow food.
You mean
forever.
You're committed.
Right. You've got to provide electricity. You've got to provide water, safety. Lots of things you have to do forever. You do it one day at a time, but you do it in a responsible way.
Maybe storing the wastes for thousands of years will create enormous problems. Maybe not. I've got to admit, I'm prejudiced against the idea of giving our grandchildren's grandchildren our messes to take care of. On the other hand, at least nuclear power doesn't generate the kind of waste products that fossil fuels like oil and coal and gas do. Huge amounts of these fuels are used in cars and power plants all over the world.
We now understand that coal and oil plants and natural gas plants contribute to global warming, whereas nuclear doesn't. And it has a lot of environmentalists doing some rethinking and saying, maybe if we can build a safer generation of nuclear plants, this could help us solve an environmental problem that's an even bigger worry than all the issues you're raising about nuclear.
Meanwhile, until that next generation of nuclear plants comes along, the people who live down the road from Yankee Row remain philosophical about their nuclear neighbor.
I don't know, we see both sides of it. You know, you see the no nukers and then you see the people that are positive for it. You know, hey, we've lived with it all our lives, so, you know, it's just part of life, you know. There's nothing we can really do about it, you know, if it something does happen, but we don't expect anything to happen, you know. You know, everything is pretty safe.
Hey, a tanker car could come in through here with gas or whatever and that could blow up. It would be just as, you know.
Be worse than that.
Yeah. You know?
You mean there are other things in life besides nuclear?
Of course. Yeah. Yeah,
life's a chance, you know. That's part of life. We live with it.
Where do we go from here? What's our nuclear future? An important part of that future will be technology. It will also be people. Here at the University of Lowell's research reactor, some of the coming generation's nuclear engineers and reactor operators are in training.
It's not dangerous.
it's a nuclear power plant is not going to blow up. And a lot of people think that because they don't understand.
While I was at the University of Lowell, I thought about the experience of the French, who generate over 75% of their electricity in nuclear power plants. So I asked the professor about it.
And the French experience, because they generate an awful lot of...
The French modeled their reactor technology after the Westinghouse design. Seabrook technology is what the French technology is based on.
But why are people marching against Seabrook?
I don't see people marching against Seabrook anymore.
Oops, he got me on that one. Seabrook is the newest American nuclear plant to go online. So, presumably, it's the safest. But it's too early to tell. Seabrook has only been at full power since last August.
Welcome to the future of commercial nuclear power in the United States.
Now, there are even newer plants on the drawing board.
And the design provides the added assurance that the containment building would contain and provide cooling to the fuel in the unlikely event of a core meltdown.
Core meltdown sounds like the voice of the apocalypse, but the next generation of reactors should be simpler and safer than what we have now.
First of all, there's a great deal of experience with nuclear power plants. Now, a new design can encompass all of this operational information and create some features that would make them perhaps easier to operate, simpler in their design, maybe less valves, less piping, you know, shorter wiring and instrumentation.
Some of the designs look safer than the current generation of nuclear plants, but they still look like they can fail catastrophically. They haven't solved the problems of nuclear waste. They haven't solved the problems of nuclear proliferation.
Advanced reactors, greenhouse gases, war in the Persian Gulf. Where can we go from here? On January 29th, President Bush appeared to offer an answer.
A comprehensive national energy strategy that calls for energy conservation and efficiency, increased development, and greater use of alternative fuels.
Conservation, efficiency, alternative fuels, of course. But in the morning paper a few days later, I noticed General Schwarzkopf looking nervously past General Powell to a headline that read, "Bush's energy plan emphasizes gains in output over efficiency." Sure enough, the fine print of the president's energy plan calls for more nuclear power plants and more output of fossil fuels. It shows little interest in conservation or alternative sources of energy. The fiscal 1992 budget, proposed early in February, calls for only $3.5 billion for energy research spread over 5 years. Where does that leave the nuclear debate?
Each side on this debate has a vested interest in having you believe their extreme position, whether it's pro or anti. You have to weigh those, and you have to say, we demand other options out there, not just nuclear or no nuclear.
Because the other options have not been funded enough to tell whether they'll work or not.
Because the other options intuitively seem safer in terms of solar and conservation, and they just make so much more sense, but they've been given no support by the government and no chance really to work.
Should I jump down?
As a father, you wonder about the next generation and the one after that. You think those cliched thoughts about what kind of world will we leave them? In the last weeks, I've heard some reasonable arguments that make me more wary of greenhouse fuels and a little less scared of a nuclear future. But after all that, my heart is still not convinced. In the end, I just want our society to fight like crazy for less dangerous, less destructive alternatives than either fossil fuels or nuclear power. But is anybody listening to people like me? I'm just a citizen. The only answer my last letter to the White House got was a very polite form letter.
Ron, were you satisfied with the conclusion you reached?
Well, in a way, I'm not satisfied with the conclusion. It would have been convenient to be able to find out once and for all either pro-nuke or anti-nuke. But that didn't happen. What really became clear was it's important to go for conservation and alternative sources of energy, at least in my viewpoint. And as it happened, while we were working on this show, the national energy policy was announced, and very disappointingly, it doesn't push for conservation or alternative uses of energy. It's really more of the same thing. It's more fossil fuels and more nuclear.
Ron, thank you very much. That's Greenwatch for tonight. But before we close, we have important information we want to share with you. Here's our executive producer, Lisa Schmidt.
Thank you, Ann. I want you to know that New England's program on the environment is in trouble. We are all very proud of Greenwatch, and we hope it has helped you better understand your environment. We want to keep providing this service, but we're in the middle of a very painful recession. TV stations have cut back on local production, and since the war began, advertisers have also cut back. WLVI took a gamble with Greenwatch, an innovative program. And although we are growing, unless we get a major sponsor or a much larger audience, the show will be canceled. You've been a loyal audience. Thanks for your support. And tell your friends about us, and if you know of a sponsor, tell them to give me a call at Channel 56. Thanks and good night.
Whoa, mercy, mercy me. All things and what they used to be lost, oil wasted on the oceans and upon our seas, fish full of mercury. Oh, mercy, mercy me. All things and what they used to be lost, radiation underground and in the sky. Animals and birds who live nearby us die.